You're always pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
Take a seat. So on Thursday afternoon, a number of students and parents gathered around the grade 3 classrooms at St. Luke's Anglican School for the grade 3 art show. And this year they've been studying pop artists, and they've got Andy Warhol and all sorts of other people. And there's the guy who does, you know, the red and black the squares, and the Jackson Pollocks that the kids have done. They were fantastic. Oh, I was really impressed. And it got me thinking about the role of curators in an art gallery. Because it's not just a matter of going, oh yeah, there's a pretty picture, and putting it on the wall, which is probably what I would do. It's like, oh look, that one, oh yes, I've got a blank spot. And now I've got, ha ha, I'm a success. No, there's work and thought, and they look at the philosophy behind the paintings and the artworks and, you know, the color juxtapositions and all these really fancy things. The gospel writers, in a sense, are curators. They don't write down everything that Jesus did. They're not slavish diarists walking around behind going, oh, look, okay, and he was very careful, he didn't tread on that thistle. I'm sure it means something spiritual. We write it down. That's what happened. These are, I mean, they're written sort of sometime between 30 to 70 years after the death of Jesus. And they've gathered together their recollections, the recollections of other people, and they've written down a biography. They've curated a narrative of Jesus. Which makes it always interesting when you get things that look a little bit like maybe they don't match. And you ask yourself the question, what did, we'll assume it was actually a person called Matthew, we don't actually know, by the way, historically, if the person who wrote the Gospel of, according to Matthew was actually called Matthew, but that's the tradition of the church. So what was Matthew thinking? We've got a story about sheep. We've got this thing about arguments in church, and then we've got this odd language about stuff being loosed in heaven. Did he do it, Andrew? Did he just go, oh, I got a blank spot on the page, I think I'll just whack a canvas up there? I don't think he did. So I think the theme is, you are wrong. I think that's the theme for these three little sections. And when I say you, I don't just mean you. I mean us, you. So the first story is the story about sheep. And I'm pretty sure you've heard this before, that sheep in Australia and sheep done in around the time of Jesus, they're done a bit differently. In Australia, we've got thousands of sheep. We use helicopters. They didn't use helicopters very much back in Jesus' day. Maybe it was the cost of fuel or something. A flock of sheep that's got 100 is huge. It's ridiculously large. And no sensible shepherd leaves 99 of them on the hills to go looking for one. The sensible shepherd goes, oh well, I've got 99 here, one's lost, that's a perfectly legitimate loss. In fact, that's really good. That's only 1%. And if you own a store and you only lose 1% through, what do they call it? Shrinkage? People sticking stuff in their pocket and walking out. That's considered pretty good. That's considered pretty good. And Jesus says, you are wrong. Because God cares for every one of those sheep. Every one of those sheep are worth going and looking for. Your 1% loss rate that you think is acceptable isn't. You are wrong. look at the next one. If your brother or sister sins, go and point it out to their fault. So someone in the church, or perhaps actually your biological brother and sister, or in the community, has done something. Go and talk to them. That seems like good psychology, doesn't it? It seems like the kind of thing Dr. Phil would say on TV. Go and talk to them. If that doesn't work, go and take two others, two trusted, wise, sensible people along with you. Now, the first thing that's interesting here is if you're bringing trusted, wise, sensible people and you're having an argument with someone, they might not be on your side. So there's a first clue here that things might be a little bit not what we would expect. Our natural inclination is to gather together people who agree with us and to go and have a confrontation. That still doesn't work. Maybe these two trusted, wise people have gone, well, actually, I can see both sides of this argument. Or maybe they agree with you, and the person you're having an argument with isn't willing to listen. So you bring it to the church. And they refuse to listen to the church. And the natural inclination here is to say, well, you didn't listen, you're keeping up with this thing, and for our own safety, and for our own personal integrity, we need to cast you out. This is what some people think of as excommunication. Not something we do very often in the church these days, is it? Excommunicate people. But that's the notion, is that the people are being taken out, are being ejected, if you will, from the church. And Jesus says, you are wrong. You are wrong. Treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. How did Jesus treat pagans and tax collectors? As if they mattered profoundly. Jesus didn't turn his back on them and go, tax collectors, I don't know what you guys get up to in your spare time. He possibly did, because he sat and ate with them. He extended a hand of love and generosity to people that the rest of society would have said, not worth the effort. So, you are wrong. And then there's this next one. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done by them, for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three gather in my name, there am I with them. I remember as a kid, Jesse, a friend of mine, he and I were walking along and we were discussing our relative theologies. We were like grade 5 or 6. And we'd gone to the swimming pool, we were going to his place to go and play computer games, and we were talking about God. We didn't think kids to do, but anyway. We were talking about this thing that two or three are gathered in my name. Basically, God will give them whatever they want. And we thought, you know, do we test this? Because the Bible says don't test God. This would be an interesting test, wouldn't it? So what do two young boys pray for? What do we ask for in God's name? I can't remember. But here's the thing. We were wrong. Because we were not gathered in Jesus' name. See, we often sort of use this word, and we don't quite necessarily understand what it means to be gathered in a person's name. Who likes to go to, have you seen the Comic-Cons? Do you know those things? You've seen them on TV maybe? And you get all these people and they dress up. And he likes to dress up as Batman. And he's got these most amazing Batman outfits. And he goes and he tries to dress up like that. But he also takes it quite seriously, and occasionally he'll go to the children's wards, like when they're doing like the things, and he'll dress up as Batman and he'll take photos of with little kids, because he goes, that's what Batman would actually do. He tries to wear the character of Batman. He doesn't, I don't think, go out in the middle of the night fighting crime. He never mentions that part. I think that does, who knows? I think so. When we gather in God's name, in Jesus' name, and we ask for something, we need to remember that we're doing so in Jesus' name. And that means what we're asking for is, what would Jesus ask for in this moment? Not what's the most handy thing for us, so, you know, two young 10-year-old boys, a new bike. No, that's not what Jesus would ask for. Possibly an opportunity to share with someone, maybe. Wisdom to see the person in need and to do something about it, maybe. But those of us who tend to think that we use Jesus' name as a stick to assert authority in the world, or as a lever to try and garner for ourselves stuff, we are wrong. These three little sections that Matthew has curated for us, has put on the wall, they look different. They look very different. But the theme is, we are wrong. And art has a function, I'm told, by three-year-old artists, year three artists. It's to encourage us to think and reflect and react. So if we've been told three times that we are wrong, how should we react to change so we are right? The other theme is, is that the love of God is far greater than we would expect to be. We should be working to expand our definition and our experience of love so that it comes closer to that of God's. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.